SSDs are an essential part of every PC build, but if you are a new builder, you might have some questions about installing them. In this video, I'll walk you through installing both M.2 and 2.5 inch SATA SSDs and give some tips to consider. Let's get started.
This video is sponsored by SK Hynix, the maker of fastest in class SSDs. SK Hynix developed the world's first 128-layer NAND-based consumer SSD and is the world's second largest memory manufacturer. But what really sets them apart is incredible performance at affordable prices, surprising power efficiency, and 5-year warranties. In fact, SK Hynix makes PC World's top picks for best all-around SSD and best NVMe SSD. Grab the gold P31 or S31 on Amazon and give your PC a big upgrade.
Luckily, installing an SSD is easier than picking an SSD or even understanding how they work. Now, I'm not going to cover any of that here, but if you want to check more on the topic of SSDs, check out the links in the description. Assuming you already have an SSD in hand, let's get to installing. I have both an M.2 NVMe SSD and a 2.5 inch SATA SSD from SK Hynix here, but the steps should apply to almost any model. I'll start with the M.2 SSD because it's a bit more tricky to install and there are some things to research before you do it. Also, I'm going to install this drive in a motherboard outside of a case, but this can be done even if you've already built your PC. It's just easier for me to show it this way. The first thing you want to do is find where the M.2 slot is on your motherboard. In order to orient ourselves, I'm considering the side of the motherboard with the back I/O connections to be the left side. With that in mind, we are looking for a slot about 1 inch wide that protrudes from the motherboard about a quarter of an inch. It is not always labeled. Now, every motherboard is different, but the most common locations are below the CPU and around the PCIe slots in the lower half of the board. If you are struggling to find the placement, you can always consult the part of the manual that shows the motherboard layout. Some motherboards even have a pre-installed shield in place that serves double duty as a nice piece of visual flair and a heat spreader. This will obviously have to be removed before you can access the M.2 slot. If your motherboard supports two M.2 SSDs, you'll need to consult your manual to see which slot is the recommended place to install your boot drive. Each slot might offer different performance levels, while others might turn off a PCIe slot if used. Basically, read the manual first. Once you've found the right slot, find the screw about 3 inches to the left that is inserted into a standoff. The standoff is there because when the drive is inserted, there will be a gap between the SSD and the motherboard, so the standoff plays a crucial role of keeping the drive flat. If your motherboard doesn't have the screw or standoff, look in the box it came with where there might be a small plastic bag. If your motherboard features an M.2 shield, you will need to find two screws that mount it to the motherboard. Now it's time to touch something metal, like a piece of furniture, in order to ground yourself, and then grab a screwdriver. Unscrew the screw from the standoff and place it somewhere safe. You do not want to lose a screw or have it roll around your motherboard. For those of you with shields, unscrew it from the motherboard, but take note of the underside where there should be a thermal pad with a piece of plastic over it. Do not remove the plastic yet, just place the shield someplace safe. Now, the most common M.2 size is 80mm, like this gold P31. To confirm, you can hover the drive over the slot and take note of the length. There are other sizes of M.2 drives available, and if you happen to have one of them, you'll need to use pliers to loosen and move the standoff to the appropriate length. Once it's in the right position, make sure the standoff is screwed in fully. You don't want it spinning while you are trying to install the screw. For those of you with shields, you most likely don't have a standoff specifically to screw the drive into. Instead, there should be a brace of some sort for the drive to rest on while the shield holds it in place. In either case, the next step is to insert the drive. When I'm considering the top of the drive, there is usually a sticker that is okay to leave on. It's actually recommended. The side with the gold contact points is what we are going to insert, and the side with the semicircle cutout is what is going to be held in place by the screw. Note the notch where the contact points are. You'll want to line that up with the slot on the motherboard with the top of the drive facing you. Insert the drive fully at about a 15 degree angle until there is no more give and let go. If you have a screw and standoff based system, you'll want to press down on the drive so that it lies flat and the semicircle cutout lines up with the standoff. While holding the drive flat, insert the screw and tighten it to a comfortable point. Take care not to over-tighten or you risk damage to the drive, the screw, or the motherboard. If you've installed it correctly, the drive should not shift in place at all. For those of you with shields, you'll have a bit more to wrangle, so take your time through these next steps. Since there is no screw to keep the drive flat, you'll have to hold it down while you place the shield over it, or get help from somebody who can lay it flat while you handle the shield. If you would like to do a dry run without taking the plastic off the thermal pad, that is a great idea. Just be sure not to leave it on permanently. When you are ready, take the plastic off and lower the shield straight onto the drive. Now it's important you lower it straight onto the drive because the thermal pad is tacky and may cause the drive to slide out of its slot if you shift it after it's adhered to the shield. Now if that does happen, don't panic. Carefully remove the SSD from the thermal pad and start over. The hardest part here is lining the screws up to the standoffs, so one trick is to hold the screws in place on the shield as you lower it. This allows the screws to touch the standoffs before the thermal pad touches the drive. Once the screws are lined up, lower the shield into place and tighten the screws down. Again, no need to over-tighten them, it just needs to be snug. And with that, your M.2 NVMe SSD is installed and ready to use. The last thing to note here is that there are some M.2 SSDs that feature their own built-in heatsink. If your motherboard has a shield, you don't want to place it over the included heatsink. Just store the shield somewhere safe in case you need to use it later. The Gold P31 I used does not have a built-in heatsink, but don't fret, it's still an energy efficient SSD that emits low heat and should perform great in any configuration. Now let's move on to installing a 2.5-inch SATA SSD. This installation is much more dependent on the PC case you are using and where you want to place it, which varies wildly. So instead of an exact step-by-step guide, I'm going to cover the basics that will always apply to every installation. Once again, I'm assuming you already have a drive in hand. If not, check out the link in the description for help deciding what to buy. The two most common methods for installing a drive in a PC is either to put it in a hard drive cage or to secure it to the case itself. Drive cages usually have some sort of method to attach the drive to the tray that slides into a cage. Mounting it to the case can either involve screwing the drive to the metal or putting the drive into a tray first and then attaching it. Either way, take care to make sure you have enough cable length to safely route the cables inside the case. When installing a 2.5-inch SATA SSD, you will always need two things: a SATA data cable and access to a SATA power cable. Most motherboards include a SATA data cable in the box. This is used for data transmission from the drive to the motherboard. Look for a long, thin, and flat cable, sometimes with an L-shaped connector at the end. The SATA power cable, which provides power to the drive, will be included with the power supply and usually have multiple connectors in line. In order to use the SSD, you will need to have both cables attached and secured to the drive at all times. Plugging in both cables is simple. Look for the end of the drive that has the connections and note there are two. The shorter port is for the interface cable and the longer port is for the power cable. And if you look really close, each port is keyed with a tiny notch that indicates the correct orientation for the cable to plug into. Because of this, there is only one way to install the cable. So line them up and insert firmly. The interface cable includes a primitive locking mechanism that gives a subtle click when inserted. The power cable does not lock in, so be sure to press it in all the way for a secure connection. The interface cable will then need to be plugged into the motherboard. In this orientation, you will find the ports on the right side of the motherboard, somewhere between the middle and bottom. There will most likely be multiple ports to choose from, so now is another time you should consult your manual. To get the maximum bandwidth out of your SSD, you'll want to connect to the SATA 6 gigabit per second ports, but the slower 3 gigabit per second ports will work fine as well. In this example, you can see that this motherboard features 6 SATA 6 ports, and they are stacked, so 3 columns of 2 ports. Typically, you'll want to use the ports in order, so if the numbering starts at 1, choose that and identify which port it is on the motherboard itself. On any remotely modern PC, the performance should be the same, but using the first port on an older PC is usually the highest performing. When the ports are stacked like this, sometimes it can be a bit confusing knowing which number is which, so take your time and look close. Once again, this cable will lock into place, so after you insert it in enough, you will hear a subtle click to know you are secure. And like that, you have attached your 2.5-inch SATA SSD. A couple more things to note. Like I mentioned before, some of the SATA data connectors feature an L-shaped plug. This is for situations where you need to keep a low profile so the cable doesn't get pinned somewhere, but either cable offers the same performance. Also, the SATA power cable will most likely have multiple ports on it. This is to allow you to attach multiple drives or peripherals onto the same cable. Which plug you use will depend on the length you need to reach the plug in the drive and whether or not that cable also needs to reach other ports. All the plugs will work just the same. Wow, who knew this topic would be so involved? But of course, there's even more I could be covering, but hopefully this should be enough to get your PC up and running. I'll leave you with one last tip before we wrap up. If you were installing both an M.2 NVMe and SATA SSD, you might be confused as to which drive is which when it comes time to installing Windows. One way to get around that is to keep the SATA SSD unplugged while you're going through the installation process, so there is no other option for installing Windows to something other than the high-performance NVMe SSD. After you are up and running, plug the drive back in, format it, and you are ready to roll. Well, that's it for this how-to. Be sure to subscribe to PC World for more PC hardware videos. I'll catch you in the next one.